was individuals that were given either 50 micrograms of LSD or an inert placebo, and it was a pair of twins, 5 years old. And they were, at the time in the study, they determined these individuals had a failure to make use of objects appropriately and a failure to develop speech. They played patty cake with them, peekaboo, things like this, and behaviors were recorded and documented. The scientists did know that there were like increases in social behaviors, increases in eye-to-face contact, increased responsiveness, and decreases in self-stimulatory behavior. As you can see through the lens of that like first lesson, where it's like the target of some of these treatments is like to eliminate some things that might be like regulatory mechanisms for the individuals. And we see the same thing in cannabis as well. Like restlessness is like undesired for a classroom setting because it's distracting. That individual might also be like kind of developing like a pattern of comfort or self-soothing. So it's balancing that and contextualizing it and like creating some sort of intelligent society that can like recognize that if someone's shaking, they're okay. And like being okay with them communicating that to others. Like in our all autistic space, it's very easy to do that. In other spaces where there's bullies or whatever, it's not as easy to ask for those types of things. And again, all of these are kind of emergent and easier to handle in older groups and groups that can participate in that dialogue with language, with like consent and all these other things. But only those two subjects were observed, and again, just the acute drug window, these effects were mostly observed. And then the final from the pre-prohibition era was this, the use of psychedelic agents with autistic schizophrenic children. This was more of a review, summarizing all the papers that were done. Believe it or not, by then, Hoffman had also synthesized psilocybin after, they brought it back from Mexico and synthesized it. So at this time, they were administering psilocybin as well to these individuals. So it's like some early evidence, because there's yet to be any other clinical observation of psilocybin. The Toronto study I mentioned earlier is going to be like the first fully buttoned up, fully everything that we're going to have as far as clinical pipeline. But there were 7 studies, 91 total children were observed. Most of them covered the age range of 6 to 10 years, mostly refractory. Again, it's kind of hard to generalize because there's so many different agents used, different dosage levels, different frequencies, and different schedules. The most effective seemed to be when 100 or more microgram doses were given, but again, this was over like extended periods of time. There's a couple of case studies if you want to go deep on it. There's like one individual went from like fully like incapable to like eventually going into like school again after like many years. But that same study highlighted the fact that like the clinician conducting the study was like super invested in caring for the person. They basically like raised them as like a parent almost. Like, so like there's something, it wasn't like the drug, it was the container in which they were receiving this care that allowed them to also like rehabilitate and like re-enter the world as well. So it's like, wow, LSD did it. It's like, no, like you can't remove the human element from something that dramatic. It's not going to be as simple as like, you know, some sort of miracle overnight thing. And again, just for whatever it's worth, for the fact that these individuals were put through this thing, there was improved speech pattern. There was like forming of syllables when there was otherwise like muted children. There was increased responsiveness, elevations in positive mood, laughter, decreases in some of the ritualistic behavior, which has that complex kind of layer to it. But you know, that was an examiner quote from the time was, the vocabularies of several of the children increased. Several seemed to be attempting to form words or watch adults carefully as they spoke. Many seemed to comprehend speech for the first time or were able to communicate their needs. Very few of these changes in communication have been noted previously in such a large number of them or at such a relatively rapid rate. You know, I originally included this study in my first book because it resonated with me, even as an adult. I was like, dude, my body does body stuff. Like, I know that now, and I can intelligently, like, do that without even, like, needing to be guided on it, because my body, like, is guiding me. Like, if that even makes sense to anyone who's ever been really dissociated and then suddenly not. It's simultaneously jarring, and then it makes absolute sense. It's like, I didn't need any guidance. I was like, oh, cool, so this is a body. All right, it bodies. Like, great. Like, and that was my experience, and I think, I wonder a bit, but, you know, there's steps and protocols of getting there. MAPS is obligated by the FDA to do an adolescent study with MDMA as part of, like, the regulatory procedure. After it gets over the fence, they're then going to move into an adolescent trial. They typically do those trials with, like, people that are also, like, very treatment-resistant to something. I think I last heard that they were going to target, like, war trauma survivors. Being like, well, this is a teenager, maybe it's risky, but so also is being a war traumatized teenager for 5 more years just to wait to take this drug. So maybe we should try to trauma heal them now instead of subject them to 5 years of reclusivity and whatever else. So it's complicated. There are steps and procedures in place. And, you know, there's plenty of compounds that we know of that are much more either neurotoxic or, like, you know, harmful to liver, many other organs that we also administer in these age ranges now. But we're not yet there to say with any certainty what the safety and efficacy is going to look like through, like, an FDA-like lens for any of these adolescent groups, except for ketamine is the only exception we have right now within these groups. We certainly get unsolicited reports from parents all the time that are letting us know that cannabis oil is helping their children or that psilocybin is helping their children. But I can't in good faith advise that anyone do that, because I don't advise anyone do anything, honestly. Like, I might be on a fast track to something bad. You know, like, I've chosen a quality of life, but, you know, even microdosing has shown potentials for, like, valvular issues to come up later in life from the 2B triggering. So, like, not everything, you know, anything we take in, I'm having matcha, it's going to cause some other downstream effect on my body. You know, we don't fully know, so, you know, a lot of this is coming through this lens of, like, hey, we're gathering stories, the science is coming, there'll be, by 2 years from now, we'll have, like, 4 or 5 solid data sets with autistic people taking these compounds, getting brain imaging, getting blood data, all of this stuff. We'll know a lot really soon, and we'll talk about, like, how we'll know that in future studies. But I'll skip over these additional quotes, just more of the same. So, like, I was kind of holding my breath through that section, because it's like, me 5 years ago seeing that, I kind of transposed myself onto you guys, being like, oh, that's so interesting. Now I kind of look better with the sort of, like, ah, it's kind of like, I don't know, that's not, like, the nicest thing to look back at. Because at the time, I was like, oh, look, it's evidence, LSD, useful. But, like, in that context, it's like, it's a very kind of reckless use of the compound. And we have much more elegant ways of approaching and looking at it. So now we're looking at some Renaissance era findings. So again, for context, there up till now, if you search PubMed for psychedelics and autism, you're only going to really find like the MAPS MDMA study and the studies that are currently in progress. There hasn't really been any others other than the ones we touched on from the pre-prohibition time. So what I'm really doing with this next section is looking at kind of like a series of studies that validate that humans, given this drug, have this change. Therefore, it might be that that particular type of change might be useful to an autistic person. It's so many layers of complexity because the autistic brain has no agreed-upon neural correlate, so we cannot really necessarily say. Even, like, for example, there's the COMPASS study right now. They're giving autistic people psilocybin and non-autistic people psilocybin. But it's not as simple as autistic people and non-autistic people. They have this very specific inclusion criteria that further, like, defines and further defines it, to where they're essentially looking at, like, one subtype of autism as compared to, like, one subtype of typical development. And, like, that's more of a mechanistic study. It's not even an outcome kind of thing. So it's all really complicated. It's all to say that, like, not every study I'm about to talk about is about autistic people. It's about, like, autistic challenges that might be alleviated that we could potentially validate by observing autistic people that would see similar shifts as the typically developing patients in these studies. That all makes sense. This is actually an appropriate time to take a quick second for a question, because I've been talking for a while. Does anyone have any general questions? Because I've just been talking at you for a while. I welcome a question or a clarification at this time while I hydrate. No? No questions?
Is there anything about MDA, or is it all just MDMA?
I'm not personally versed in MDA, so I will just leave it at that. I do know that there is, indeed. If Miyabi Shields, she's one of our collaborators, she's doing a cannabis class with us, actually, a 7-part class in September on autism and cannabis. And she's also, she's a pharmacologist by trade and neurodivergent, and she talks a lot, actually, on her TikToks and things like this. She has a site called ProjectChronic.com that might be worth checking out. They talk about MDA there. She also comes up with, like, different smoke blends of, like, CBG, CBD, THC ratios, stuff like that. But she's great. She's, like, an expat, basically, of the science world that still publishes papers, but, like, also, like, calls out the limitations. And, like, I don't know, it's pretty great. ProjectChronic.com, yeah. And if you go to our website, too, the cannabis class is on our site that she's going to be teaching. She's a tremendous resource. She's, like, I don't know, she's my hero. She lives in Salem, where it's also decriminalized. She's trying to build, like, a mushroom community and all these things there. Research community, yeah.
Like, when I was talking about my son, I said that he's a lot better now. I mean, because I'm listening to you talk about, like, not wanting to fix, which I completely agree, but most of my son's symptoms were more like comorbid, you know, like OCD, like body, sensory tics, like all of this. It was severe. So I'm just curious, because at least for us, those were the most debilitating symptoms and the most improved. But he's still who he is, you know, which I'm glad. But I'm curious, like, how much research is going into that, because I can tell you from working in an inpatient psychiatric hospital that most medical professionals are very poorly informed on OCD and Tourette's. I mean, it's sad and scary, to be honest.
I mean, there's very few answers that I could give that would be necessarily informed by this, like, unique specialization or cross-overlap. I think, like, the general insight that any medical person might have towards general... the one thing I will say to that, and this is true for just about every other comorbidity, is that the complicated nature of it is, like, a lot of the research is fueled by, you know, how much of a return will come back on this investment for this research. And so it's like, depressed people, there's lots of depressed people we can get a return on researching that first. Traumatized people are next. And then, like, autistic people at that, like, 100 and something million or lower. And then, like, the cross-diagnostics of, like, then it's, like, even smaller and smaller. So a lot of that can, right now in our group, we resolve that by being, like, that's why I say we have the Sunday peer support, but it's also, like, a mutual aid meeting, because there's people that are, like, I can't wait 15 years for science to tell me what this is happening. So it's people that are exchanging wisdom between themselves. But as far as, like, you know, my knowledge of how that's being addressed right now, presently, we're only just now getting to, like, OCD observation period, like, as the only diagnostic that person carries, otherwise typically developing with OCD, to try to kind of, like, clean the data set up. But as you'll see, like, most autistic people rarely have just autism. There's, like, probably no one has just autism. Like, probably, like, there's this, I think it's, like, 85% have at least three, like, could qualify for three or more diagnoses, which makes sense. We break down all those criteria. Like, if you can complete a PTSD screener, you're, like, 90% of the way to being autistic already. It's just, like, a few other boxes to tick, and then you're, like, yes, you're autistic. So, yeah, that's a long-winded, nuanced way of saying, like, we're getting there. I don't have authoritative enough knowledge, but I can at least kind of paint the picture of how the various things that obscure and confound the ability to get that knowledge, which kind of speaks to why we're kind of addressing a lot of this through, like, intuitive community care models where, like, people are listening into their bodies, listening into each other as they're going into, like, subtle and safe dosing with some of these things just to kind of be, like, that feel, like, safe and comfortable for me to explore at that depth. And, like, just pushing it. But those are people that are facing other really detrimental situations and making kind of autonomous choices with their own informed consent.
Now, so I, this is what helped me, but, so I do neurofeedback and neuromodulation, but there's stuff that the world of neurofeedback and neuromodulation, like we know, for instance, like my tics, they live in 4 to 8 hertz. You can actually find them and you can train them. So I've been able to get rid of Tourette's syndrome before just by specifically finding the area of the brain where it's got 4 to 8 hertz, oftentimes the anterior cingulate gyrus, and then you ramp it up and train it to do 13 to 15 hertz, which speeds it up. And you can watch the symptoms dissipate. You can't always promise you get rid of all of them, but it's unbelievable the movements you can get using neuromodulation tools, which is especially with PMF, is a non-invasive way of ramping up the brain. In autism, a lot of slow activity, so I do something called perception of emotion test for autistic kids, and just it'll give you faces like a kid, someone smiling or smirking, and they have to kind of be able to determine, you know, exactly what mood's being showed. And I have kids who failed it, and then I've been able to train their temporal lobes to speed them up, because usually they have a lot of slow wave activity, which makes it more difficult for the emotional reciprocity of the other people. And when you wrap them up and I have them take the poet again, they can pass it. Not every time, I can't promise, but it's pretty cool what can be done. But again, it's more popular in Europe and Canada, where big pharma doesn't run the show.
Yeah, no, there's a lot, and if anyone, I've mentioned it maybe, but we have a Sunday open meeting any time if you guys ever want to drop in for sharing about any of these things. Like, we've had meetings that go for like 10 hours sometimes because we just keep passing it. Someone's like, I can't host anymore, but we'll keep the room open. Someone else just, you know, it's just a big open listening space, and where it's like a global thing. And it's the exact kind of place where we welcome people to kind of just like educate others and like share about what's working for them. A lot of our, you know, people are, you know, like, things in recent weeks, people are talking about, like, EMDR in combination with, like, ketamine therapies and, like, so many other things, neurofeedback, VR stuff that's coming out, all sorts of, you know, there's one thing in common in a lot of our meeting spaces is people, like, really going off on a tree branch into a new kind of approach a lot, and figuring out, like, how they can figure something out about themselves through that. So it's a lot of, like, N of ones that are trying to solve a problem that nothing... There's not a lot of affinity out there in the medical world to try to solve the problems of the few. So some of these people are really just kind of solving it with this cluster of other people who have their hypermobility affinity group within our autism psychedelic group. It's like this weird corner where there's like 10 people are like solving some really novel situation for one another that it would just never make the to-dos of the industries per se. Not like to be against anything. It's just like purely how the system is architected to not really have the incentive to try to figure out these really obscure issues.
Yeah, that actually was going to be one thing that I brought up was the hypermobility and autistic individuals, like Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and then there's also like Chiari malformation. And one of the things that I'm super interested in, because I have EDS, is the meeting of the like using psychedelics for like chronic pain. As well as like in autistic communities, and like I'm just kind of wondering like what you've seen, like.
I mean, there's tons, and thankfully there's tons of smarter people than I on it. There's the Psychedelics and Pain Symposium that Psychedelics Today does, and they're going to be launching like a dedicated like symposium, like a whole dedicated event to psychedelics and pain. We also have a channel in our Discord. If you go to our website and click the button that says chat with us, there's a whole channel that's just like chat about hypermobility, and like tons of people are for the same reason, because everyone's like, this is the same kind of vibe of like, I'm going through this by myself. My doctor's kind of learned about it in a book, but like, because it's the weirdest of things that work for people, and like things that other, like, because they'll go like the physical therapist, they'll be like, don't bend that way. They're like, actually, no, that actually helps me. They're like, what? No, that's not possible. They're like, no, but like, they literally don't like have that joint there. I'm like, well, okay. Like, so there's really nuanced stuff, but just to say, in the Discord, there's channels, and if anyone ever wants to make another channel, you want to make a neurofeedback channel, I don't know, anything, there's infinite internet, and we can just keep connecting people around the world to, like, the same kind of affinity interests, and that's been how a lot of people are finding their ways out. Like, you can learn more in a Facebook group sometimes. Don't fully follow it all to the T, but, like, at least, like, plumb that for discovery, and then still try to involve as much professional care as you can with it. That's my advice on talking to doctors, is talk to doctors, because doctors know stuff. Even though some of us are somewhat traumatized by certain medical experiences, like, knowledge is important, and especially when we get to contraindications, stuff like that, be super sensitive to it. So again, for the sake of contextualizing where we're at,